wishing you a lot of happy birthday, Chris. Ricky. You daisy.
And you'll start singing?
Yeah, I will. I'll start singing really loud. I'll stand up.
Yes.
Drop kick.
Okay, can we start? Do you want to take your seat and let's start? Guys, I'm waiting. Thank you. Okay, so this morning we're going to talk about the knee joint. Last week we spoke about the hip joint. And when we talk about the knee joint, we'll also talk about the muscles of the thigh at the same time. Now remember, because the knee joint actually is in the middle between the thigh and the leg, any muscles that pass across a joint will actually move the joint. So there's some muscles that attach on the leg that actually cross the knee joint, and so they will work in the knee joint. And there's muscles from the side that come down to the leg bones, and they will also work on the knee joint. So any muscle that crosses the joint will have some action on the joint, right? Today we will look at just the thigh muscles, and later on this week you'll actually look at the ankle joint and you'll look at the rest of the leg muscles there as well. Now, I realized this morning when I was on my way here that I put these questions into your notes and I gave you the answers as well. Did I? Yeah, so anyway, we'll still go through it. So, let's just try and recall what the answer for this is without reading the answer. So, the iliotibial tract, remember we spoke about it last time I saw you. Which of those options do you think is incorrect? And since you have the answer, you should be able to tell me why it's incorrect as well. Okay, so it obviously is A, because the smiley face is next to A, but it is A because, remember, the fascia lata is the thickening of fascia in the leg, and the iliotibial tract is the thickening that is located on the lateral side. So it is not medial, but it is lateral. And the rest of the options are, of course, correct. Okay, what about this? Which of the following statements regarding the femur is most correct? You have the answer, so the answer is obviously about the angle of inclination, and that's correct. But let's go through the incorrect ones and see why they're incorrect. So the femoral shaft has no muscles attaching posteriorly at the distal end. Now, when we do the femur today, we're going to see that there's a whole lot of muscles that actually attach distally. So all of those gluteal muscles, well, not the gluteal muscles, but the adductor group of muscles that we were talking about yesterday, lots of them will go and attach posteriorly on the femur. The greater trochanter, is it easily palpable? Or is it not easily palpable? It's very easily palpable, isn't it? If you palpate on yourself, you should be able to palpate your greater trochanter. If you can't, then speak to me afterwards and we'll see whether you're feeling in the right place. Linea aspera is the ridge between the two trochanters. True or false? It's false. And why is it false? What's the ridge between the two trochanters called? No one? So it's between the trochanters, so it'll be the intertrochanteric crest. Perfect. And the adductor tubercle, that's a bit of a tricky question because I haven't done that with you yet and we'll do it just now. Okay, so for today what we're going to do, we're going to look at the lower femur and we're going to look at some of the features of the lower femur. We're just going to touch a little bit on the fibula, not too much, because we don't do it in much detail, but we're going to look at the tibial plateau, that's the superior aspect of the tibia, because that's the aspect of the tibia that is involved in the knee joint. And then we're going to look at the knee joint in a lot of detail. So let's do that. The knee joint is actually probably one of the more important joints for you to actually understand, because it is the joint that you will see very often in sport injuries, in injuries around life, and one of the reasons for that is that the knee joint is fairly unstable. So unlike when we spoke about the hip joint and we said it was really stable, the knee joint is exactly the opposite. It is a really unstable joint, and you'll see why it is unstable just now. So we're looking at the distal end of the femur, and on the distal end of the femur, if you look at this view here, this is the anterior view and this is the posterior view. We know this is the anterior view because we can see the greater trochanter, but we can't see a lesser trochanter, whereas here on the posterior view, we can see both a greater trochanter and a lesser trochanter. Now that is obviously the shaft, and on, I can't remember when I saw you last, but when I saw you last, we said that posteriorly on the shaft is this ridge, and this ridge that you can feel quite distinctly posteriorly, that's called linea aspera. Now, as linea aspera projects upwards towards the greater trochanter, this area here will be called, does anyone know? The gluteal tuberosity. Good, excellent. Now, if we look at the inferior aspect, you can see the inferior aspect has two large condyles. Those two large condyles are large, they're round, and they are called the femoral condyles. There's a medial femoral condyle and a lateral femoral condyle. Now, if we just look at that condylar region a little bit more closely, that's what we're looking at here. We still have linea aspera. We still have the two condyles. So what I want you to really notice is that the medial condyle, which is the condyle we're looking at here, is larger than the lateral condyle. That really is important because one of the things that that larger condyle helps us to do, when we're standing upright, it is part of the mechanism that allows the knee to lock. And so when the knee locks, it means that we can stand upright without expending a lot of energy. So the mechanics of the knee allows it to lock, and so we can then relax our muscles and stand for a long time. So that is the medial condyle, so that's larger. Now, in between the two condyles, you'll see this groove. This groove in between the two condyles, that's called the intercondylar surface. It's quite a deep fossa. The picture doesn't do it justice, but when you have a look at it in the dissection hall on the anatomy lab, you'll see that it is actually quite a deep fossa. So that's the intercondylar surface. The other important thing to notice is that anteriorly, you can't really see this intercondylar surface or intercondylar fossa too clearly. What you would see is a really expanded, flattened area. This flattened area we call the patella surface because that's where the patella is in contact with the femur. So this here is the patella surface. So patella surface, medial condyle, lateral condyle. Same here, you have medial condyle, lateral condyle, and the intercondylar surface. The other aspect that we can actually see inferiorly is that if you look carefully with me, you'll see on this medial aspect, can you see the femur has a little projection? That little projection here that you're looking at and here, that is called the adductor tubercle. It's colored in red in this illustration. The adductor tubercle is where we would have one of the heads of hamster of the one of the heads of the adductor magnus that will attach there. Okay. Okay, so that is the adductor tubercle. And then just like in the femur, the edges of the femur that start tapering towards the shaft, those edges are called the supracondylar ridges. That's the area in blue. And that's the area that you would see here. So it's the area that starts tapering towards the shaft. Okay, so that's the femur. Now when we look at the tibia, you'll see that there's two bones in our leg. One is called the tibia, and it's the bigger, fatter, more robust-looking bone. The second bone in our leg is called the fibula. Now, if you look at the fibula, you can see it's really long and slender, whereas the tibia is the one that is thicker and stronger. The tibia is our weight-bearing bone. Now, when we talk about the knee joint just now, you'll see that the tibia is the bone that actually participates in the knee joint, and the fibula doesn't. The main purpose of the fibula in the leg, like in the forearm, was that it actually provides an area for muscle attachment. So it increases the area that is available for muscle attachment. So the tibia is actually our weight-bearing bone. Now if you look here again, this is anterior and that's posterior. On yourself, it's really easy to figure out which is the tibia and which is the fibula, because the tibia is in the anterior surface here. The tibia is largely subcutaneous, so it's directly underneath skin. So if you feel along your bone, you'll feel the tibia, the anterior surface of the tibia. So that's the tibia there. Now if we look a little bit more closely at the tibia, you'll see that the top of the tibia is flattened, and it's actually flattened and roundish, and that area is called a tibial plateau. You know, like the plateau of a mountain, the top flat surface? This is the surface that we're looking at here. That's the tibial plateau. Okay. On that tibial plateau, you'll see these little projections that are projecting upwards. Those projections that are projecting upwards are the area between the two condyles, so they are called the intercondylar eminence. So this is the intercondylar eminence. Now for us, when we're doing the knee joints, they really become important because that's where these cruciate ligaments that you may have heard about before will actually attach. So this is the intercondylar eminence. And like the other bones, this has a medial condyle and a lateral condyle. If you feel on yourself as well, just underneath your knee joint, you'll feel a round bump. That round bump underneath here is called the tibial tuberosity. That is where the quadriceps tendon will pass down and attach. So the quadriceps muscle is a muscle that's forming our anterior thigh muscle. And its tendon passes down, attaches to the patella, and then via the patella ligament will attach here to the tibial tuberosity. We're going to see that just now. Okay, and obviously this has a shaft. The shaft I told you just now has a subcutaneous border anteriorly. That's the part that you can feel. Now inferiorly, if you look here on the tibia, on the inferior aspect of the tibia, on the outside, you will see that it projects downwards into a tip. That tip that it projects downwards into is called the medial malleolus. Now if you feel on your ankle, you actually don't even have to feel. If you look on your ankle, that big bump that you can see on the medial side, that big bump is your medial malleolus. Okay. So if we look at the posterior aspect of the tibia, the one big feature that we should note on the posterior aspect is that there is a line that passes from lateral to medial. This line that passes down obliquely downwards, that's called the soleal line. It sounds like a funny word, but it's actually related to the soleus muscle, which is the bulk of the muscle that forms the calf of your leg. And we'll do that when we do the leg next time. Okay. And obviously, if we look at the fibula, there's the head of the fibula. The head is projected upwards into an apex, and it's projected all the way down into the lateral malleolus. Now, if you feel in your ankle, laterally, you can even see the lateral bump. That lateral bump is called the lateral malleolus. Okay, so that's about all that we're going to do on the bones for now. And then we're going to start looking at the knee joint. So when we're looking at the knee joint, we actually need to keep this picture of the tibial plateau in our mind, because we're going to refer to that just now, and the femoral condyles. Now, if you look at the knee joint is actually a very complex joint. It's made up of three separate articulations. So this is looking at the knee joint, and the knee joint in this picture is flexed. So here's the tibia, and there's the femoral condyle, and the rest of the shaft of the femur is projecting backwards. Okay, so the three articulations that make up this knee joint is this articulation on the articulation on the lateral surface between the lateral condyle. So there's the lateral femoral condyle and the lateral condyle of the tibia, and likewise the same on the medial side. So that's two articulations. And the third articulation is between this little bone, the patella and the femur. So three articulations, patella and femur, and then the two condylar articulations. I've got that there already. Okay. Now the type of the joint that we're going to see, so this is the same joint that we're looking at from the lateral aspect. There's the tibia, there's the femur, here is the patella. The patella is in contact with the patella surface of the femur, and it moves up and down as the joint actually flexes. This joint, we'd say, is a modified hinge joint. Why do I say it's a modified hinge joint? So you know on yourself, on your knee, you can do flexion and extension. Can you do any other movements with your knee? And if you say yes, you have to tell me what? Yes, so you can also do rotation. So you can do flexion and extension, but you can also rotate. So if you flex your knee 90 degrees, you can turn your foot in and out, and that's the rotation of your knee joint, right? So we can do flexion, extension, rotation, and this knee joint also glides around. So although we say it can do all of those different movements, when we classify this joint, we classify this joint as a hinge joint, but as a modified hinge joint. And the reason why it's modified is because it allows the other movements. The reason why it allows the other movements is, unlike when we looked at the ulna and the humerus, the ulna has a trochlea that locks onto the condyles of the femur, condyles of the humerus, and so doesn't permit any other movement besides flexion and extension. But here, when we look at the articulating surfaces, you'll see that the femur condyle lies on a flat surface, so it's like a ball lying on a table. Can you see that? So it's round, and that's the table. And because there isn't a locking of the two articulating surfaces, it means that it also allows the rotation movements and the gliding movements. Okay. Now, if you look at this here, obviously, if you place a ball on the table, it is fairly unstable, because that ball can roll around in all kinds of directions. So this joint is actually not a very stable joint. It's probably one of the weaker joints, and the joint capsule that we have is also fairly weak. The thing that actually holds this joint in place is the large number of muscles and tendons that actually surround and brace these joints. So there's lots of tendons that pass all the way from the hip bone down over to the tibia, and as they pass down, they actually brace the bones in its place. And there's also a number of ligaments that we'll talk about related to the capsule that will strengthen this joint. And that's how these bones are actually held in place. So the strength of this joint is not in its articulating surfaces, it's really in all of the surrounding structures. Now, because of that, all of the surrounding structures actually become important. So I told you already, about the articulating surfaces, and those are the surfaces that we were talking about. The other thing I want you to actually note is that between the articulating surfaces, if you look here in this picture, there's a wad of cartilage. Can you see that? One, two. Those wads of cartilage is actually very carefully structured, and they are called the meniscus. One meniscus, two menisci. And we're going to talk about the meniscus just now. The other structure that actually stabilizes this joint is a set of ligaments that passes within the joint. Can you see these two ligaments that cross each other? They are called the cruciate ligaments. So there's an anterior and a posterior cruciate, and we'll talk about that just now. These structures, the anterior and posterior cruciate and the menisci, lie within the joint capsule. We'll talk about all of that in detail just now. So the articulating surfaces are the condyles of the femur, and it is the patella. More specifically, it will be the posterior surface of the patella, as you're seeing here, and the condyles of the femur and tibia. all of the articulating surfaces that take part in the knee joint will be lined with articular cartilage. So the blue is showing you articular cartilage, and in this case, the articular cartilage is hyaline cartilage. The posterior surface of the patella also has hyaline cartilage that lines it. So all of the articulating surfaces are lined by hyaline cartilage. And that is the typical feature of a synovial joint. So if you look at the articular cartilage, I'm just going to put this here. Okay. So if you look here, this is the tibial plateau that we looked at just now. And what you can't see because it's covered by structures is that intercondylar eminence that lies in the front. Now this is anterior, so right over here would be the tibial tuberosity, and this is posterior. Now this intercondylar eminence is where we would find lots of ligaments attaching onto the knee joint. But before we even talk about those ligaments, you'll also notice the C-shaped cartilaginous half ring. That's called the lateral meniscus laterally, and likewise there's a medial meniscus medially. So both this wad of cartilage that we're talking about is a half a ring shaped wad of cartilage, and it intervenes between the two articulating surfaces, between the tibial condyles and between the femoral condyles. If you look as well, you'll see that the shape of these two cartilages are slightly different, and we'll talk about that just now. In the intercondylar eminence in the middle, there's two structures that I will attach, and those two structures are called the cruciate ligaments. There's an anterior cruciate, which we can see attaching anteriorly, and a posterior cruciate. So both of these come off the intercondylar eminence, and they pass upwards, and as they pass upwards, they cross each other, and they go and attach onto the femoral condyle. So that's how they cross each other. So from here, this will pass upwards and medially, and it will attach onto the medial condyle, and the anterior one will pass upwards and backwards, and it will attach onto the lateral condyle. Everyone good with that? Yes. Okay. So that's the cruciate ligament. Now the next thing that I want you to have a look at is just look more closely at these menisci. Now the way these menisci actually form is that when it is formed, the outside, this area here, is thicker, and as you project towards the midline or towards the middle, it becomes thinner. And so this cartilage, if you had to cut it in cross-section, what kind of shape do you think it would have? So it's thick on the outside here, and it's thin as we come towards the inside. It'll be wedge-shaped, isn't it? It'll be thick on the outside, and as we come towards the inner side, it'll be thin. Now, this wedge-shaped menisci, what it actually does is it serves to deepen the socket. So it kind of forms a socket, a slightly deeper socket, on which the femoral condyles can sit. When it's attached, it's actually these outer edges here that are attached, and the rest of it lies freely on top of the tibia. So these edges here are attached or fixed, and the rest of it is fairly free on the tibia. The main function I should have told you of this menisci, they formed out of cartilage, and so one of its main functions is actually to act as a shock absorber for the knee joint. So as you're walking, it cushions the femur on the tibia. So if you look here, and I've drawn that blue wedge shape in, that would be how the menisci look in cross-section. So it's wedge-shaped in cross-section. And so it forms that little bit of a deeper socket for the femoral condyle to sit in. Now if we look quickly at the patella, you'll see that the patella, if you look at the patella is a sesamoid bone. A sesamoid bone means that it is a bone that grew in the tendon of a muscle. So at first when it grows as a cartilage, and then over a period of time it normally becomes bone. Now a patella, if you feel a baby's knee, a baby who's just born, you'll probably feel that there is no patella there, but as they start growing, you'll find the cartilage develops and very quickly it starts becoming ossified. So this here is the patella. The patella, if you look anteriorly on yourself, it is subcutaneous, meaning that you can feel it underneath skin. And if you look even more closely at one of the patellas in our lab, you'll see that it has a larger surface and it has a smaller surface. So if you put the patella on a table, it will normally lie on its larger surface, and it will lie on, that would be the lateral surface. That's one of the ways in which to decide whether this is a right patella or a left patella. Fortunately, you never have to do that this year. Okay, but that's just one of the ways in which you would decide that. And if you look at it, you'll see there's a groove in the middle, and the reason why there's a groove is because it fits nicely into that patella fossa, or the patella surface of the femur that has a groove down the middle. Okay, now the important thing about the patella and why I am talking about it is that anteriorly, in the anterior compartment of the thigh, the bulk of your muscle in this anterior compartment of your thigh is made up by a muscle that we call the quadriceps muscle. Now, it's called quadriceps because, anyone want to warrant a guess? Foreheads, brilliant. So it has four heads, unlike biceps and triceps. This is the quadriceps. And all of these four heads converge into one tendon. So if you look here, the one tendon that it converges in down here is the tendon in which the patella developed in. So it's a sesamoid bone that develops in the tendon of the quadriceps femoris muscle. But as time has passed, that patella has become subcutaneous, so that quadriceps tendon actually inserts on the top part of the patella. Can you see that here? So it inserts on the top part of the patella, and the rest of that tendon has become a ligament that we call the patella ligament. And the patella ligament will extend from the patella onto the tibial tuberosity. It is really important in terms of the knee joints because this contraction here, the patella tendon, the patella and the quadriceps tendon, the patella and the quadriceps tendon, it actually totally replaces the joint capsule anteriorly. So when we look at the knee joint just now, you'll see anteriorly there is no joint capsule. It has been totally replaced by this complex that we have here. Okay. So, right, I'll come back to that. So if we look at the capsule, we look at it posteriorly, the capsule is actually complete. It will attach up here to the articular margin of the femoral condyle. It will pass all the way downwards and it will attach to the it will pass downwards and it will attach down onto the tibia itself. Anteriorly, what we have is the quadriceps tendon, the patella and the patella ligament that totally replaces the joint capsule. So there's no joint capsule lying anteriorly. Does everyone get that? Brilliant. Okay, so when we talk about the synovial membrane, like when we talk about the synovial membrane in any synovial joint, there's one statement that is true for all. It is that the synovial membrane actually lines any part of the joint surfaces and capsule that is not covered by hyaline cartilage. So when we spoke earlier, we said that the femoral condyle and the tibial plateau is covered with hyaline cartilage. So everything else within the capsule that is not covered by hyaline cartilage will be lined by synovial membrane. So that's the synovial membrane that we would see there. But in the knee joint, what happens is that synovial membrane actually extends quite far upwards. And when it extends quite far upwards, superiorly, between the quadriceps tendon and the femur, it forms a really big bursa underneath the quadriceps muscle. Now you can imagine that if the quadriceps muscle is attaching anteriorly onto the tibia here, every time you're flexing and extending your knee, it's causing loss of friction. And so this bursa that lies here is the bursa that actually reduces that friction in your knee joint. This bursa is called the suprapatellar bursa. Now here, we can see it as being quite small, but in some people, that bursa can actually extend quite far up the thigh, up to about halfway up the thigh. So it can be a really big bursa. So that's the suprapatellar bursa that I was talking about here. There's also other bursa that is associated with the knee joint. The one colored in blue that you can see here that lies in front of the patella, that's called the prepatellar bursa. And inferior to that, we have the intrapatellar bursa. Both are the intrapatellar bursa is actually intervening between the patella ligament. Posteriorly as well, there's a bursa called the semimembranosus bursa, which is related to a muscle of the same name, and we'll talk about that just now. Now, the pre-patellar bursa that you are seeing here, sorry, is the bursa that in the old days it used to be called the housewife's knees when it used to get enlarged, and that's what you're having a look at here, a pre-patellar bursitis. These days it tends not to be called housewife's knees, but it's actually caused by repetitive movements on your knee that actually causes this bursa to enlarge over time, like you can see in this person here, which is a man, by the way. Okay. So if we look at the capsule itself, you'll see that the capsule is actually reinforced by a number of ligaments. And he really already spoke about the first ligament that reinforces the joint. And this first ligament is the patella ligament. Remember, it's the part of the quadriceps tendon that actually inserts from the inferior aspect of the patella down to the tibia, and it's become a ligament, so it's called the patella ligament. If you feel your patella on your knee and you pass inferior to that, you can actually feel the length of your patella ligament. Okay, on the lateral side, we have a cord-like ligament that reinforces the joint. This cord-like ligament extends from the head of the fibula up towards the femoral condyle, and this is called the fibula collateral ligament or the lateral collateral ligament. Okay. Now here, if you look at this fibula collateral ligament on the lateral side, you'll see that it does not come into contact with this structure here. What structure is that? The lateral meniscus. Good. So it does not come into contact, it does not attach onto the lateral meniscus, because there's a tendon of the muscle that actually intervenes between these two. This tendon of the muscle is called the popliteus tendon for the popliteus muscle. So what this muscle does is that it arises here laterally on the femoral condyle and passes posteriorly in your knee to then attach onto the tibia. This muscle is going across, and it is the muscle. Remember I said when we're standing, we are able to lock our knee, and so we don't use energy. This tendon here is the main tendon that allows us to unlock our knee. And so to unlock our knee, what it does is that it pulls the knee slightly laterally, and when it pulls the bone slightly laterally, we can unlock our knee. Okay, so this tendon that intervenes is actually an important functional consideration. For this reason, because the tendon and the ligament don't attach onto the meniscus, it is actually makes this lateral complex much more stable. Whereas if we look on the medial side now, we'll see on the medial side, this orange band here is the tibial collateral ligament or the medial collateral ligament. As it passes down from the tibia, as it passes down from the femur to the tibia, it actually passes down and attaches onto the medial meniscus. And because it attaches onto the medial meniscus, it actually makes this medial complex a bit more unstable. And so in contact injuries, like people will play football and ice hockey and things like that, this is the ligament, when they get a whack onto the side of the knee, this is the ligament complex that actually gets damaged and torn. So medial meniscus and medial collateral ligament tears are much more common, and it's more common because this complex actually attaches onto each other, whereas on the lateral side, the lateral collateral ligament and the lateral meniscus are separated from each other by this tendon of the popliteus muscle. Did everyone follow that? I think so. The other thing that you would find laterally is the attachment of the iliotibial tract. Remember we spoke about iliotibial tract before. It comes all the way up from the hip bone, passes down on the lateral side, and then attaches here onto the lateral condyle of the tibia. Now all of these ligaments that we're talking about, the medial collateral ligaments, the lateral collateral ligaments, even the cruciate ligaments, they all are taut when we're standing up. So when we're standing up, they are all taut and they hold our joint in place. When we start relaxing our joint or flexing our joint, as we flex our joint, these become progressively looser. Okay. So that means their main function is to reinforce this joint in what movement? In full extension, like I'm standing up, isn't it? Okay. So if we look here again, this is showing you exactly the same thing. So this here is the lateral condyle, and this here is that popliteus tendon that intervenes between the two and so separates this from each other. Now, the capsule, besides being reinforced by that lateral ligament and the medial ligament, is also reinforced posteriorly, and it's reinforced posteriorly by a ligament that passes upwards. Can you see this ligament here that's passing upwards and colored in blue? This ligament is called the oblique popliteal ligament. It's an interesting ligament because what happens is on this side here, which is our medial side, we have one of the hamstring muscles that comes down and inserts here called semimembranosus. We're going to talk about that just now. But as it inserts here, what happens is that its tendon actually reflects upwards as the oblique popliteal ligament. And this oblique popliteal ligament will reinforce the joint posteriorly. In a similar way, we have a second ligament that reinforces the joint laterally and posteriorly, and this is called the arcuate popliteal ligament. It also blends onto the capsule of the joint. Now, this arcuate popliteal ligament is actually interesting because there's been studies that show that the size and the strength of this arcuate popliteal ligament is related to a sesamoid bone that is found in the gastrocnemius muscle. So down here, posteriorly, we have a muscle called gastrocnemius, which is also a muscle that forms the bulk of the calf of your leg. And there is a strong relation between the strength of this ligament and the presence of a sesamoid bone in that muscle. The second thing that I wanted you to actually know here is if you look here, can you see this muscle that we are looking at? This muscle is this popliteus muscle that I've been talking about. So its tendon arises here on the femur. It passes laterally and downwards. And as it passes laterally and downwards, it comes to sit or comes to insert onto the tibia. This oblique popliteus tendon is the tendon that actually intervenes between the lateral collateral ligament and the lateral meniscus. If you look at this here as well, you'll see that if this is full extension, if I pulled on this ligament, it will rotate the femur, and as it rotates the femur, it will unlock the joint. That's the iliotibial tract, which I've shown you before, and you know already. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about the cruciate ligament. So if you look here, this is a picture looking inside the knee. There's our two femoral condyles. That would be the tibial plateau or the tibial condyles. And you can see some of the meniscus on this condyle still here. These are lateral ligaments that we're looking at there. The structure that you can see inside in the middle and crossing each other is the cruciate ligament. The one that we can see fully is the anterior cruciate ligament, but behind this is the posterior cruciate ligament. So if you look at the same thing from the lateral view, this is how the ligaments actually look at. They cross each other. Now, they cross each other, and they are the main factor that actually prevents over-rotation of the femur on the tibial plateau. So it prevents over-rotation and so holds the femur in place. It is also the ligaments that will prevent over-extension and over-flexion of the femur. So there is a test that's called the anterior drawer test and the posterior drawer test. Have you all done that in clinical skills yet? No. But you will do that in clinical skills, and what that actually tests is it tests the rolling of the femur on the tibia. So if the femur actually rolls too far anteriorly, it actually is a test to show that the anterior cruciate ligament is damaged or torn, or if it rotates too much posteriorly, it is the opposite. Now, these cruciate ligaments, what happens with it is that it lies within the joint cavity. But within the joint cavity, it actually lies outside of the synovial cavity. So that is not so easy to understand, so I'm going to explain that again. So if we look here, this is the joint cavity that we're talking about, and so in a living person, it will be surrounded by the capsule of the joint. Now, we said that every part of the capsule, every part of the joint surfaces that is not covered by hyaline cartilage is actually lined by the synovial membrane. So this here, it's actually lined by synovial membrane that way and then that way. Can you see that? And so because the synovial membrane goes like that and like that, it forms two separate synovial cavities within the joint. And these ligaments that are within the joint are within the joint, but they're outside of the synovial cavity. For that region, when orthopedic, for that reason, when orthopedic surgeons actually operate in this area, they consider this two separate cavities totally, because it is actually separated by two separate synovial membranes. Okay, so what I also want to tell you is this. So when you actually, what these ligaments do, I told you, they actually prevent over-rotation. So when you flex your knee on yourself, right, try and do lateral rotation and then try and do medial rotation on your flexed knee, and tell me which one can you do more of. Can you do more lateral rotation or more medial rotation? Who can do more lateral rotation? Yeah, so if you do this movement correctly, you'll see that when you flex your knee joint, if this was my knee joint, you can do less medial rotation, but you can do much more lateral rotation. And the reason for that is, when you actually do medial rotation, these two cruciates actually twist on each other. And when they twist on each other, they actually, can you imagine twisting or tying around each other? And so when they tie around each other, they limit the amount of medial rotation to about 10 degrees. Whereas when you do lateral rotation, they untwist and they come to lie more straight or more perpendicular. And when they untwist, they allow you to go right up to about 60 degrees. Do you understand that? So the medial rotation on your leg is actually limited by the twisting of the cruciate ligaments on each other. So let's talk a little bit about, okay, while we're here, we'll also talk about meniscal tears. So meniscal tears are fairly common, and the reason or the mechanism that actually causes a meniscal tear is when someone is standing, like in this person here, and they would have been walking in one direction or running in one direction, and suddenly twist their knee to turn. And when you suddenly twist your knee to turn, that is when they tend to tear their medial ligament or the medial meniscus. Okay, so the medial meniscus or the medial meniscus tears are usually occur when somebody is moving but their feet are planted when they actually start doing rotation. So you often find it in football players as they're running in one direction, they grab a ball and they suddenly tear, or they suddenly turn, and when they do the sudden turn on a planted foot, that's when they start tearing or damaging their menisci. I explained the unlocking of the knee, but I'll do it again just now towards the end when we actually do the muscle. So when we were talking about compartments of the thigh, we said that there was three main compartments of the thigh. There's an anterior compartment, a medial compartment, and a posterior compartment. The anterior compartment of the thigh is usually our flexors of our hips. But remember, because our limb actually rotated in development, what has happened is that our knee actually extends opposite to our hip joint. So whereas our hip joint flexes anteriorly, our knee flexes posteriorly. And because of that, this anterior compartment has hip flexors in it as well as knee extensors. The medial compartment is our adductors. They bring our legs towards each other. And then the posterior compartment is largely a group of muscles that we call the hamstring muscles. Has anyone heard the term hamstring before? Yep. So that is the muscles of our posterior compartment. So we're going to look at those muscles very quickly. So if you look at the medial compartment, these are the muscles that we're actually looking at in the medial compartment. This medial compartment, if you can see, you'll see all these muscles actually arise from the pubic bone. They pass downwards and they insert onto that linea aspera that we were talking about. The linea aspera lies posteriorly on the femur. They're actually arranged in three layers. They're called adductor brevis, adductor longus, and adductor magnus. And their names will actually tell you what the muscles are. So we're going to look at them quickly. Sorry. So if you look here, this is actually showing you the pubic bone. This muscle that we can see from the pubic bone passing downwards and inserting onto the femur, that is called pectineus. Pectineus is a bit of an odd muscle because it actually straddles two compartments. It's partly an anterior compartment muscle and partly a medial compartment muscle. But so what it actually is able to do, because of where it attaches, it's able to both adduct and flex the thigh. So this is pectineus. But the rest of the muscles that we're going to be talking about now are true adductors. The first adductor you can see going all the way from the pubic bone right down onto the femur. It actually passes all the way onto the back and is attaching onto the tibia. So what you can't see here is that it passes all the way down. And if you look here at the bottom, you can see that it attaches onto the medial aspect of the tibia. This muscle is called gracilis. It's a really thin ribbon-like muscle. It's called gracilis. And gracilis is a really weak adductor of this joint. The next muscle, and the main muscle I actually want you to see in this diagram, is the first of these three big adductor muscles that we're talking about. The first one that we can see here, it's a triangular-shaped muscle. It's called adductor brevis. Adductor brevis, again, comes from the pubic bone, from the inferior pubic ramus of the pubic bone, passes all the way down and attaches onto linea aspera. So if we look at that, that was adductor magnus. So remember that in your mind. The next one here that we have is adductor longus, also passing from the pubic bone and onto linea aspera. So this gap that you're looking at here, the muscle that is missing from here would be adductor brevis. So adductor brevis onto linea aspera, adductor longus also onto linea aspera. These two muscles are actually coming from the pubic bone, one from the superior pubic ramus and the other from the inferior pubic ramus, inserting onto the femur and onto linea aspera of the femur and so adduct the thigh. With that muscle, we also have the magnus, the biggest one, and if you look here, this is adductor magnus. Now, adductor magnus is quite big. It is also a muscle that straddles two compartments. So it's partly a adductor, and it's partly a hamstring. So if you look at it, you'll see that it has two different kinds of origins. The one origin and this big part of the muscle here that we can actually see attaching onto the femur, onto linea aspera of the femur, this is the adductor part. So it's very similar to adductor brevis and adductor longus. It's just a lot bigger, so that's adductor magnus. This is the adductor part of adductor magnus, and it will also rise from the inferior pubic ramus. But as it passes backwards, there's a second part of it, and the second part of it comes from the ischial tuberosity. Now, I don't show you on this picture the ischial tuberosity, but if you remember when we did the hip bone, we said the ischial tuberosity was that big, bulky part of the ischium that you sit on. So all of our hamstring muscles arise from this ischial tuberosity. And this hamstring part of adductor magnus also comes from the ischial tuberosity, and it will insert onto that adductor tubercle that we spoke about a little while ago. So this here is the hamstring part. Now, because this muscle actually straddles two compartments, it means that it is supplied by the nerves of both compartments. Okay, somewhere in the back of your mind, you need to keep that point in your mind. Okay, so that's the adductor compartment. The three main muscles that you need to know is adductor brevis, adductor longus, adductor magnus. By and large, all of them come from the pubic bone and insert onto linea aspera, just at different points because they all are different lengths, except for the adductor magnus, which has two parts. Now, anteriorly, the bulk of the muscle that we have anteriorly is the muscle that we call the quadriceps muscle. The quadriceps muscle is our main muscle that extends the knee joint, and it's the one that we just spoke about when we spoke about the quadriceps tendon and the patella ligament. Now, it is actually made up of four different muscles, and they each have a name. The one that is slightly different from the rest is called rectus femoris. Rectus means straight, femoris means femur, and the reason why it's called that is that it passes straight from the hip bone, straight down through the middle of the muscle, and you'll see it passing right straight down like that over the middle, and that is called rectus femoris. The rest of the quadriceps muscle is what you're seeing in this diagram, and they divide it into three parts. So they're quite a vast muscle, and so they're called vastus. There's a vastus lateralis, the lateral part, vastus medialis, the medial part, and then the part in between is logically called vastus intermedius. Now, this muscle is quite important in reinforcing the knee joint. So down here, we have it inserting onto the patella as the quadriceps tendon and then to the patella ligament, by the patella ligament to the tibial tuberosity. Now, if you look at this muscle as it passes down, you'll see that lateralis and medialis actually spans out and inserts widely onto the patella. This part that inserts widely onto the patella, they play an important role in actually stabilizing the knee joint laterally and medially. Can you see this part here? And this part here, they actually play a very important role in stabilizing the joint. This joint, this vastus medialis as well, in addition to just inserting there, as we stand straight up like I'm standing now in full extension, this muscle here actually pulls this bone slightly towards the medial side. And when it pulls this femur slightly towards the medial side, it adds to that locking mechanism that we spoke about. So it locks the joint by pulling the femur towards the medial condyle. Okay. And so the popliteus muscle that unlocks it does the opposite. It pulls it laterally and so unlocks it from being locked into the medial position. Okay. So if we look at each one of those, there's vastus lateralis, vastus medialis, and vastus intermedialis, and it's showing you all of the attachments of these muscles. By and large, all of the vasti come from the femur. That's where they're attaching, and they're attaching from different parts of the femur. You don't need to know the specific parts of the femur that they actually arise from, but they all insert onto the patella tendon, onto the patella, and then via the patella ligament onto the tibial tuberosity. The rectus femoris is slightly different. It's coming from the anterior superior iliac spine that you can see there, and it passes straight downwards and it inserts also onto the patella itself. Okay, so that's slightly different from the others. The third compartment that we actually have in the thigh is called the posterior compartment, or you know it very familiarly as the hamstring muscles. Now, like we said, there was the vastus in the anterior compartment. In the posterior compartment, we say in general they are the hamstrings, but the hamstrings are actually made up of very distinct muscles. The first part of the hamstring is the muscle that we call biceps femoris. The second is semitendinosus, and semimembranosus is the third. So I'll tell you why each one is called what they are. But in general, all of the hamstrings arise from that ischial tuberosity, your sitting bone, and they pass downwards and attach either onto the tibial condyle or onto the fibula head. There's only one that attaches onto the fibula head anyway. So if you look here, we look at biceps first. Biceps, obviously called biceps because it has two heads. One head is coming from the ischial tuberosity, like we said. That is the long head. The short head is coming from the femur itself, and both pass down and they insert onto the head of the fibula. So they pass downwards and they insert laterally. The other two muscles that we can see are semitendinosus and semimembranosus. When you see them in the lab, you'll see that they normally very closely related to each other. They normally sit in each other. And the way to distinguish them is that one is membranosus because it has this really big, flat, membranous kind of attachment. If you look here, can you see the broad, thick attachment? Whereas the other is tendinosus because it tends to have a long, thin tendon. So membranosus is because its tendon is actually flat and broad, whereas tendinosus, its tendon is thin and cord-like. Both come from the ischial tuberosity. A semitendinosus will attach onto the medial border of the tibia, whereas the semimembranosus, it is the really important muscle in terms of the knee joint because it passes down, it attaches onto the medial condyle, and then its tendon actually does a backflip and becomes what we spoke about before, the, anyone remember? The oblique popliteal ligament. Remember we said that its tendon actually inserts here and then passes backwards and reinforces the knee joint. So this is semimembranosus, and that is the muscle that does that. Okay, now the thing that you should actually remember is, remember the big attachments, where they come from in terms of their general attachment, but here inferiorly for these three muscles, you should be able to distinguish their attachment. It becomes important because it encloses an area that is called the popliteal fossa, which lies in the back of your knee, and there's a whole lot of important structures that pass there that you will do in the next lecture. So just in the last few minutes, I'm going to talk a little bit about popliteus and about this locking and unlocking stuff that probably confused you already. So if you look here, we spoke about this here. We said that there was this oblique, this was this popliteus muscle. It passes from the lateral femoral condyle, like you can see in this picture, and its tendon passes and intervenes between the lateral collateral ligament and the lateral meniscus. Its muscle then passes backwards and it inserts onto the tibia. This muscle here is the muscle that is responsible for unlocking the knee joint. Now, to understand how it unlocks the knee joint, you actually have to know what is locking the knee joint. So locking the knee joint is, like I told you, is the mechanism that we have to be able to stand erect for a long period of time without expending a lot of energy. So when you get up from your chair, when you stand up straight, in the beginning you will be using muscle that is contracting. But once the muscle contracts and gets all the bones aligned in the correct place, the bones and the ligaments, by the way they are designed, will be able to manage that erect position without using lots of muscular energy. The way it does that is that the anterior cruciate ligament that we spoke about becomes taut in full extension, like now. And then because the medial condyle, remember we spoke about the medial condyle of the femur? Did I put a picture there? Yes, I did. So if we look here, this is the medial condyle of the femur. The medial condyle of the femur is slightly larger and more bulkier. So when we stand upright and we put the femur on top of the tibia, the natural tendency is for all the muscles to pull it medially. And that vastus medialis that we spoke about is one of the muscles that will pull it medially. So here is the upright joint. What happens is the anterior cruciate here becomes really taut in full extension. The vastus medialis will draw this medial condyle medially, and when it draws it medially, it locks it in position by the joint surfaces and their shape. Okay, the iliotibial tract will also then be maintained.